the financial support the Republicans and Democrats receive in their quest for national elected office comes overwhelmingly from the very rich, the top 1% in wealth and income. Domination of campaign finance by the very rich mocks any semblance of democracy in America, because those who provide the money for anything are the people who really exercise control. The old idiom, "he who pays the piper calls the tune," illustratively encapsulates what we all know to be true. Those who finance America's two-party system, the very rich, decide government policy, control the boundaries of political discourse, and determine our choice of candidates. And the very rich are not paying for all of this because they are benevolent patriots, eager to support a candidate of character, with a pat on the back and the philanthropic exhortation to exercise your best judgment for our country. No, they consider their contribution as an investment. A typical American may contribute up to a few hundred dollars to a candidate because he or she believes in and wishes to support the ideals that candidate represents. But the very rich give thousands of dollars to a candidate because of what they believe the candidate can do for them once in office. To that end, they often give contributions to both sides. Unsurprisingly, government policy serves the very rich. The question then arises, do the policies and resultant laws preferred by the very rich accrue also to the benefit of the vast majority of the American people and the common good? The enormous fortunes of the top 1% in wealth and income allow the very rich to escape living the common life of a typical American. Wealth, in effect, largely isolates one from the common life experience lived by most Americans, and in a society that blindly admires wealth, tends to lead the wealthy to an inflated sense of their own ego and self-importance. And like everyone else, unless humbled by strong religious values or a social ethic of noble obligation, a wealthy individual naturally adopts a political and worldview largely shaped by his or her financial situation that must necessarily be fundamentally different from typical Americans on nearly all political topics. The profound disparity in political outlook between the very rich and typical Americans is mutually exclusive. Consequently, the policies and resultant laws preferred by the very rich do not and cannot accrue to the benefit of the vast majority of typical Americans or for the common good. The very rich, whether they are country club conservative Republicans or latte-drinking limousine liberal Democrats, set aside differences they may have between themselves when it comes to defending from challenge policies critical to their continued power, such as open borders, globalization, secular values, and global military intervention. Despite our vaunted two-party system, there is non-competition across basic investor interests, since neither party can oppose the fundamental policy preferences of their very rich contributors. And if we look at the record and not the rhetoric, we find that the United States is basically a one-party country, effectively ruled by a single coalition of wealthy individuals and big corporations with two wings, known as the Democratic and Republican parties, presiding over a political system where typical Americans are disempowered from exerting any direct control, where the essential details of most law is made hidden from public view, and where government policy, public political discourse, and nearly all candidates are under the strict control of corporations and institutions owned by the very rich. The financial dependence by both parties on the very rich renders representation of typical Americans impossible.